Welcome everybody back again to Whiskey Words and Wisdom. I'm Kale. We have Don, and we have a special guest that's going to be here from the jump with us today because our sweet, beautiful Jenna's out. She's sick. We have my brother who owns the place we record in, Rob Valletta. Woo!
Thank you. Yeah, thank you guys for having me.
Yes, yes, my brother from another. So, guys, it's been, what, a couple weeks since we talked?
Yeah. Man, a lot has happened.
Holidays,
have we talked? Full swing.
Oh,
full
swing. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think I talked to you guys more than I talked to anybody else. So Rob's the other guy that I talk to besides Don. So if I'm not talking to Don or Rob, I'm probably not talking to anybody. That's really how it is in my life these days. But yeah, we just wanted to have Rob on. I've been trying to get him on for quite some time. So we'll get into all the logistics of who he is after we talk about the weekends. So Don, what you been up to, man? Oh, by the way, guys, Don has been nominated for a Grammy. Let's go.
Oh, yeah.
Congratulations,
thank you,
man.
Thank you. Damn, I'll be forgetting.
You do. He doesn't post about it. He's just, you know how he is, y'all. Just chill.
Yeah, man. My mind be in the future, so. Yeah.
You spend some time with your nephews this weekend?
No, actually. I ain't seen them in like a week.
Wow, that has to be hard on you.
Yeah. I miss my little guys. I was talking to them earlier, though. Just been working, man, trying to mess with these cameras. You know, we live now.
Yeah, we are.
Trying to get that right. What else I've been up to? Prepping for the next show. Best of the best of the best coming soon.
That's gonna be lit.
Yeah, that's about it, really. Just researching, studying. You know me, man. I be in my own little world. So.
Yeah, I mean, have you seen any good movies lately?
Oh yeah,
let's go.
Yeah, did we talk about Black Panther?
Nah, we haven't.
All right, so I'm gonna go fast. Black Panther.
Rob, have you watched Black Panther yet?
Everybody's telling me not to, so I haven't.
I hate to be that guy, but follow that advice. That movie wasn't all that. The Menu though, top five.
Everybody's saying
top five of the year.
Menu, and Don was like, really? The Menu is the best movie I've ever seen. I literally saw it and went and saw it the next day. I've never done that with the film. That movie is, I might watch it again tonight on bootleg.
Nah, The Menu is really, really good.
It's that good.
Why? What was the?
Everything, like the acting was top notch. Top notch. The story. It's a satire. I didn't think it was going to be as funny as it was, but just the themes of life that it was just touching based on. I don't want to give it away. I just say go in and just watch the movie.
It hit, and
yeah,
it
but everything was just spot on.
Don told me to go in and enjoy the ride,
as you should.
And I think a lot of people had criticisms on it being too predictable. That's one of the things I loved about it is you know where it was going, but you didn't know where it was going and what it was meaning. It was just.
It's a ride.
It is.
It's a ride.
It is. Basically, without spoiling it, it shows us how much joy we've taken out of life as human beings. And that's what really hit me in that movie was like, we literally are taking the joy out of life with everything we do. We're never just present in the moment anymore. And that's an insane, like, that movie is.
But that's what makes a good movie. I mean, that's our job as storytellers, as artists, as musicians, that if you can do something and take that moment, that thing is done, that you made that thing and that done, and you're able to be like, oh, I'm not being present. Oh, I miss my ex. Oh, I miss my family. Oh, I need to do this better. That means you created something that truly is outstanding.
Yep. Facts.
You know, you're not just watching Black Panther to be entertained, which is great. Don't get me wrong. There's a whole market for being entertained.
Right.
But if you can leave with a perspective shift, you've excelled at creating something that didn't exist before.
Yep. Facts. It's being relatable on a human level because everybody's going through something, but that's what connects us. That's the bridge through everything, man. How can we relate to this? That's why we like superheroes. We can relate to them on certain levels and we see certain things like, man, I aspire to be that. I want that strength, man. If I had that power, I'd be doing this good. You know what I mean? Like, things like that.
Yep. So, in a nutshell, go see the movie. It's amazing.
Menu. What else I seen? I saw The Fablemans.
I haven't watched it yet.
I didn't like it as I thought it was going to be, because, you know, I love Steven Spielberg. That's like my favorite filmmaker. It wasn't bad. It just didn't capture me as I thought it would. But the second half of the movie, it picks up, and I enjoyed that. But, you know, I say go see any movie and, you know, see for yourself. Also, Limitless on Disney Plus, Chris Hemsworth.
I haven't watched it yet.
If you haven't watched that,
Willow just came out on Disney Plus.
Huh?
Willow just came out on Disney Plus.
Oh, yeah, I'm probably not.
Old school
that.
Willow?
Yeah.
But it's a revamp.
Yeah.
How do you revamp?
They got dude in there. I didn't know he was still alive.
Oh, it's the revamp of the old Willow.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm in.
Yeah. You know he's in Harry Potter, right?
Was he one of the?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Harry Potter's just ruling the world. Also, the main character in the menu is Lord Voldemort himself.
Yep.
Yeah. So go see it. What about you, Rob? What'd you do this last weekend?
Man, it's been crazy. I haven't been in town a lot, so when I got a chance, I got to really try to connect with my family. Thanksgiving was the first holiday in 3 years where all of our family actually got back together again.
Did you go to the cabin?
No, we went to my family's house in San Diego, and it was interesting. It was one of these bittersweet moments because throughout the whole thing, so my grandpa has stage 4 cancer. Last, you know, finished chemo, and I saw him, and everybody was saying this is it, this is his last holiday. Appreciate it. And it's interesting when you see someone, and you physically just know they're dying. Like, you can literally see them. Like, if you see someone before they're dying, like, you're like, you know, like, it's...
Oh, yeah, I've been there. Same scenario, too.
Yeah.
Thanksgiving was the last big holiday that I had with my grandmother before she passed.
Yeah. And so you're there, and you know it.
Yeah.
And I just sat next to him, and we didn't really talk a lot, but we just sat next to him, and I was just embracing that moment of just, you know, his story's amazing. He was married to my grandma at, you know, each other's first kiss. Mm. Been together for 70 something years.
That's amazing.
Had 4 daughters, lived in the same city. Did it, you
where's
know,
that
and,
at? Where's, and, where's that at?
I mean, where is that at?
70 years, yo.
So, you know, it was powerful. It was a cool moment to take that back. So I got to see my family, got to kind of, you know, reset, was there by myself. Normally I'm a creature of, I'm like a Noah's Ark. I'm always coming with a pair. went by myself. Experienced that with myself, you know, spent time with myself and my family, and that was good. So did that, and then came back, and, you know, just been grinding, working.
I know,
working.
I haven't talked to you in a while. It's kind of been weird. I text you and you don't text back.
I know. I've been going through some stuff, but yeah. Don't we all?
Yeah.
Text back.
I usually do a pretty good job texting you.
You
back.
do. He does a very good job.
That's how you know something's up. He ain't texting.
That's why I know. But I was out of town, so I was like, let me just hit him when I get back.
Yeah.
So for me, I got to go to Houston, kick it with all my Rockets Twitter folks. Shout out to y'all. Love y'all. Miss y'all. Ate some great food. Put on about a good 5 pounds. Easy. I said I'm not worrying about working out this month because I haven't been to Houston since I was a kid. And, man, the food. And it's diverse. It's not just barbecue. It's everything. I had a crab boil before I even went on the plane home, like at 11 in the morning. Had a crab boil.
Wow.
It was phenomenal. They had the ribs I had the first day, bruh. As soon as you picked them up, fell off the bones. I was like, oh man. I didn't even want to come and eat Thanksgiving dinner when I came back. I was like, it's not gonna be the same. yeah, and then I went home for a day. Prior to that, I went home and saw my kid. Then I went home for a day. We were supposed to originally have Thanksgiving as a family, but you know how families can be. We were on a group text, and the group text went south, and then Thanksgiving was canceled. And it was just like, all right, well, I guess I'm just going to go see my daughter. And me and a couple of my other cousins decided to meet up. I hadn't seen my mom physically in 3 years. So this was the first time I saw her in 3 years, like face-to-face. So that was interesting. You know, and then my cousins, who I usually see every Thanksgiving, it was the first time I've seen them in 5 years. And a lot of it was me. You know, I've been doing a lot of, like when we met, we talked about a lot of soul searching and a lot of work that I just had to sort of be in isolation to deal with my shit, you know? And so it was good to see them. And it just reminded me of like how much I love my cousins. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like they're more like sisters and brothers than they are actual cousins, because we all damn near lived in the same house at one point in time.
Yep.
So that was dope. Saw the menu twice. me and my girl went to a quick trip to Mexico. shout out to my girl. She's holding it down. She's about to leave me for a little bit, though. She's got to go back to Canada.
Shout out Mexico.
Yeah, yeah. Shout out Mexico. They lost. I mean, they won today, but they lost. They won, but lost. So shout out to Mexico. Shout out to the USA. Soccer team, baby. To the round of 16, baby. Yeah, man, that's big. I love soccer. I used to play for a while, so I love it. It's a game I love. But, yeah, I mean, I chilled a lot, too. Just more, I'm really ramping up for December. She's going to be gone, so that'll give me more time. I wanted to spend some time with her before she, because I don't know the next time she'll be back. She may be a month, maybe a month and a half. She's got to go see her kids. And, yeah, I'm really about to get into my I basically prepped myself for how I want to live the year. Me and you talked about, there was something you sent me about your goals for the year. I need you to resend me that. It was on his phone. So Rob has something on his phone that he does every year of things he needs to get accomplished. So when he opens his phone, he sees it immediately. And I'm actually going to take that and use that this year, because I need that. But I'm prepping now. So next week, I took the month off in November from working out. Obviously, I'm giving myself grace, because last year I was 252. You know what I mean? So I'm down 30 pounds from that. So thank God for that. But yeah, I'm just prepping and just mentally getting ready for everything. But I think also I've just been kind of also isolated outside of being here, talking to you guys, being with my girl. Like, I find it hard for me to go out and be around other people these days, as far as like too much overstimulation, and I get tired really quick. I think the energy in the world right now is really weird. And
it's interesting you say that. I have the same problem, but the opposite reaction. I thrive off interaction. I thrive off connection. I thrive off community.
Same, but it's exhausting me right now.
And we can get in later on, but it's also like part of a lot of my community has changed.
Yeah.
My world has changed. The people who I hang out with have changed. And so all this stuff. But yeah, no, it's interesting. And that also could just be, here's the thing. Late 30s, early 40s, you're a different man than I was. I'm not getting the same engagement that I was getting in my early 30s. And when I say same engagement, the things that I used to find myself in, it were my highs, my excitement, my this, that's a very different thing than I find myself in now. What I'm getting, like, those things don't work for me anymore.
Yeah.
And so you find yourself, and I was talking I'm in these group of guys who we train together and educate each other and push each other. And one gentleman in particular, Simon, he always is telling me, he's like, what's up with you? Where are you going? What you doing? Where's your brain at? What are you thinking? All these things. And the truth is, it's like, we're changing and we're in a limbo. Yeah.
Well, you've gone through a lot of changes over this last year and a lot of growth.
Yeah.
But we're going to get into that right now. So let the folks know who you are and who don't know who he is. Rob, I met Rob through an ex of his who's, most of you guys know, Sheena, is one of my really good friends. And she said, you have to meet Rob. You guys are very similar. And he's, you know, going on his journey of healing. And at the time, I was also in between healing and also coaching people in healing. So we had conversation and immediately I was like, yeah, I love this guy. We were on the same brainwave, you know, as far as what we've been through, the kind of destruction, self-destruction we've done, and the path of redemption we're trying to find within ourselves. So just having those constant conversations, me and you, Don, have had the same conversations where we have to check ourselves. And that's what I respected about him from the jump, is there was no excuses. He would literally say, hey, no, this is on me, and took accountability. So anybody that I feel comes to my life in my circle that can take accountability for the shit that we do, because I know I damn near know I'm not a saint, you know what I mean? So that to me shows your character. And I just knew from jumping, we just hit it off. And like, he can call me at any point in time and I'm gonna answer. If I have to step out somewhere, I'm gonna answer because it's him. You know what I mean? So let the people know who you are and what you do. This is his, his beautiful studio. So thank you again.
Are we giving the Wikipedia explanation or do you want me to give the, no, so my name is Robert Parks Valletta. I've been doing this grind in the entertainment industry for 20 years. Started out with the wanted to be the actor.
He acted in some things.
I've done like 30, 40 guest star, co-stars, recurrings, did all the network shows, but I was never the guy. You know, I did enough, but never enough to be that. And so about 6 years ago, launched a production company, did really well. Find myself, 3.5 years ago in a position of complete change, full transparency, ended up in a really bad business position, bankrupt, in debt, lost everything. At the time, moved in with one of my ex-girlfriends, her family, and started from negative 300,000. 2 years ago, launched this company, knew my passion. I knew what I was good at. And my passion's always been being in the entertainment industry and travel. And how can I combine the two? So I created this production company, which is a travel-based production company called The Destination Channel, and partnered up with CBS. And now we have, Cliff Note version. Now we have 5 shows on CBS. We are shooting 3 of those shows currently at one time. I'm hosting a few of them. But when it works, it works. But it works because you found the thing that you were supposed to do. It's like God gave you a calling. And, it doesn't make you feel happy all the time still. But I have the thing that is my purpose. So I'm a producer, a director. I wrote a book that launched last year. It was a bestseller on Amazon that's inspiring young artists of what making it in this town really is. And what making it really is not fame, fortune, money, accolades. It's making it so simple. It's taking that idea you have and not just saying, I have this idea. It's like when you had this idea for a podcast. Like, I want to do this podcast. I'm like, all right, then do it. And I was like, oh, okay, what was it about? I'm like, just do it.
Facts.
Making it is so simple. Making it is in the words. Making it. It is a tangible thing. It is something that's in your head that you have to make a reality, and I can show it to someone. Here it is.
Facts.
The moment you can go to your phone and say, here's my podcast, here it is, I've then made it. That's your only job as an artist. Everything else is a byproduct of you doing the most simple thing as an artist, which is just idea, pen to paper, execution, and go. And so my book just breaks down ways to create, how to bypass your own brain, how to make your thoughts in your head your own best friend, things like that young artists always struggle with. So I've done that. I kind of have a gamut and a charity for a long time. So I've kind of done it all, but right now, I guess you would say I am all in on helping people, inspiring people, and making travel shows that I enjoy and love.
Facts. And he just won an Emmy. He didn't say that, by the way.
Yeah.
How many Emmys is that now?
That would be 3 in 2 years.
That's wild.
Yeah.
I'm going to need to borrow one of them.
When it works, it works.
So I can flex. I'm going to need flex on one.
You want to know the craziest thing about Emmys, though? And it was one of these things I take on and off of my Instagram because I feel I have my ego that I'm trying to always keep in check. And sometimes I take off Emmy Award winner on her because it's like you have these things as an artist, as a Grammy nominated thing, as a this, as an Emmy. And I saw this documentary with Jonah Hill the other day, and he goes, when I thought I would reach this, I thought I would.
Is that the one with his therapist?
Yeah.
I need to see that.
When I thought I reached this, I thought it would make this portion better. When I reached this, I thought this. When I would have a TV show, that would make me happy. When I would have money, I thought that would make me happy. And then you realize these things you accomplish, these things that you want, these things that you go after, they're just part of the task of you making the things that you're supposed to make as an individual, but they do not fix
that is
shit.
That is very true.
They don't fix shit, and it's so interesting. And you hear it over and over again, but Jonah Hill says in his documentary, I'm telling people firsthand, like, those are things on a wall that says I'm doing the things that I'm supposed to be doing. And that's it. Do I struggle? Daily right now. More, I struggle more now in my life than I've ever struggled in my early days. Because I never did the work. I never broke down and had conversations with myself about how the heck am I going to fix this, and dealing with it and dealing with those stuff and dealing with the traumas. But yes, hi, I'm Robert. I'm a Taurus. I like short walks on the beach and I make things. and that is who I am.
That is who he is. Yeah. He is really somebody who I consider a brother more than a friend.
Same.
I can call him about anything, and we've gone through some. He and Don got to witness my last relationship where, if, like I said, if I wasn't talking to Don, I was talking to Rob, and they were both telling me, both in their own simple way, I support you, but I would get out. And, you know, it took me a while to get there. I mean, but again, these are two people who, for me, are just part of my heartbeat in and out, you know. So, he brings up something that I really wanted to discuss today, right? So we could get into a lot of the things he said, but for me, when I brought him on, I've seen his journey, his healing process, and it's not necessarily about his healing process that I want to talk about. I want to talk about the misconception of the male and how we handle things and take it, because obviously today we don't have Jenna, which I love you, Jenna, but this is a conversation that I feel like needs to be had more, as far as men deal with a lot of shit that we don't know how to necessarily talk about, who to talk about, because we get two things. We get, oh, he's an emotional person, I respect that, or, oh, he's super emotional. So it's kind of like society wants us to get in tune with our emotions, but really don't, because when we do actually let it out, it's a lot, and it's more than they can handle. Because as men, we're always taught, don't cry, be tough. And now all of a sudden in this new age, they tell you to get in tune with your emotions. Like, bro, I've been doing this for 37 years where I've been a hard-nosed, don't cry, I can't fucking make excuses, I can't be in my fucking feelings. I got to get out of my feelings and go get it, right? Because if I don't go get it, nobody else is going to go get it, right? So now that that's the case, it's like, all right, now how do I get in tune with my feelings? How do I speak to somebody and let them know that I'm emotionally not okay without being looked at as weak? So that's really
what I'm glad you've been doing that for 31 years.
37.
I haven't.
I mean.
No, yeah.
I mean, this just started for me. Like, I was telling my girl, because I sometimes forget she's a little younger than me, but I said, you know what was crazy? It's a year ago today, I wasn't here. Like, it was easier to coach people than coach myself, right? I was able to help people out, make money here and there, and help. But when it came to me, I was a fucking mess, you know? And it was like, I don't get how I'm supposed to do this, because if I speak about it, then I'm overly emotional and, oh, Kale's going to complain. I could keep it inside, but that keeping that festering inside is just something that is going to eventually boil over. And when my shit boils over, I'll burn the whole bitch down. That's just how it is for me. So now I've had to learn how to have people like yourself and Don that I need an outlet, because if I don't let this shit out, it's going to come out in a way that isn't necessary, you know? And I think that we also try to navigate to being better men. Like, the better men of men, we know the areas where we've faltered. Mm-hmm. And I think with both of us, we would love to have a companion, but we also have a hard time navigating through, we're also not going to put up with your bullshit, you know?
Yeah. I mean,
because we're working on our bullshit.
Previously, I think we used to put up with whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
For sure. I mean, I would put up with tons.
Right.
Because I had tons. I had, like, they're putting up tons with me. Hell, they were probably putting up more with me than I was putting up with them. Yeah. For sure. I mean, I look back at a lot of my ex-girlfriends and I go, Same. I'm sorry. I'm no, but legit.
Yeah, like, facts.
Like, I was always a good human. I would always, like, I'm a good human. I just made stupid conscious, bad habits and things. And so, yeah, I mean, we used to put up with a lot, but we were also given a lot.
Yeah, facts. I mean, I just think that, like, it's so, I sometimes hate this little male female like kind of dichotomy we have as far as, I respect the woman. I know they go through a lot. I know they fought for a lot, right? But at the same time, I'm not gonna downplay their struggle. You know, it should never be like, well, think what we've been through. I'm not saying you haven't been through shit, but this shit is heavy. And males commit suicide at a way higher rate. This shit we're carrying, we don't know. We're naturally not built to be this emotional as beings. You know, it's just not in us to be this emotional. So we carry so much, and it carries over with us into other shit because, yeah, we can work it away, but we'll overwork it away to try to forget the shit, you know? When is it going to be okay for us to have spaces like women's have their women's group? You know, men, where are more men groups? Where's this at, you know? What have you found to be successful as far as your journey of healing has gone? And just changing who you feel like you want to be as a whole. Like, you know who you are to the core. Yeah. You're a great fucking human being. But the places where you knew that this was toxic, this is not indicative of who I want to be as an individual. What have you done to correct that or start to work on that?
Well, the biggest thing is I think I had to want to work on it. Mm-hmm. Everything was always so easy for me. From being in LA to being out here to always getting... You know, I was always the alpha of the group. I was always conquering whatever I wanted to conquer and get whatever I want, however I wanted to get it, almost to a fault. And so it's kind of, you know, this thing where I didn't care to change because I never broke enough to want to change. I dated some amazing humans. I've been so lucky, and I've dated some amazing humans and. You know, the last one I dated, as bad as that went, I mean, man, it was to your core. Like, I never put so much work into, like, trying to change to be that guy. Because I think for the first time, I was ready and you know, she had kids. And so something switched in me, and I just said, I'm all in. And then I engaged with the kids, and I took on the responsibility, says, I'm all in. And I was, you know, my stepdad raised me. And so for me, all I know is like, I'm all in. But there was this moment where I couldn't tell you why. I mean, but that was my person. And we both went all in. And she was going through a lot of traumas because she was recently divorced. I was obviously still going through not even traumas. I was going through bad habits. Mm-hmm. I had 40 years of bad habits that I was stacking up through traumas, through hurts, through this, through deflections, through things, you know, and that's something that we all have. We all have these things that are like, oh, I got burned here, so I'm going to do this. Every time you do this, I'm going to do this. And so, you know, my biggest trauma was that every time I got hurt by my partner or do this, I would seek attention from other women to be like, you are the man.
Why do we do that?
Because, so what the work I found for
men,
me...
Most men, we do that. Like, I think it's easier for us to jump to the next instead of just sitting with our shit.
The thing is, I never wanted to jump. Mm. And I know that. I didn't want to jump. I just wanted to remind myself that, guess what? You are the man.
So your ego is...
My ego. It's all ego. And because I didn't feel and I couldn't communicate properly that said, hey, look... You're not making me feel safe, and I'm not secure in this right now, and you maybe are probably just reacting off what I'm doing, and then it's this vicious circle back and forth. Yeah. So long story short, you know, we broke up for, you know, lots of reasons, you know, mostly because I think that we couldn't come up with a center ground of she lives up north, and I live here, and we wanted to try to figure out how to make it work, and It got to the point where it did end badly, but previously before it ended, we took a break and we said, hey, look, it's time to do some work. And I took that to my core. I was like, I am tired. I'm just tired of being that same pattern of stupid relationship shit that you do. I'm tired of it. And that was the first time in my life that I was actually tired of it. I'd break up and be like, I'm cool. Moving on. Next. But for the first time, I said, no, like, I'm tired. Like, I don't want to go on again. And so for the first time in my life, I did therapy. Tried some therapists, and first one was like, tears over bands, snap your wrist every time you think of something. This. And I'm like, that's stupid.
What?
And so I went through a journey of just finding what worked for me. Yeah. And so
shout out to my therapist, by the way.
I finally found a really good therapist that does EMDR therapy. Mm-hmm. Going past through my past traumas and going through some stuff like that. But I think to go back to your question, which was, what did I go through and what that? I think it was, I finally got tired of my own shit. And I said, this no longer services me as a human. And I love someone enough and two other humans enough that I'm gonna change me so I can look in the mirror and I will like myself, because I'm looking at the mirror right now and I don't like who I am. Yep. And that's a really shitty feeling. It's a really crappy feeling when you look in the mirror and you don't like yourself. Doesn't matter what you're doing in the world.
Facts.
Doesn't matter if you're winning awards. Doesn't matter if you're doing this. If you look in yourself, and so that was my journey. My journey was, how do I actually, like, how am I proud of myself? How do I make the right decisions to be like, okay? And that was the start. That was almost a year ago.
It was about the time we linked. And I mean, how important do you feel it is for men to get to that point where they're sick of their own shit? Because I think we all, like, that was the same shit for me, is I got tired of doing the same shit and feeling shitty when my decision-making is what caused me to feel shitty. So I had to start blaming others and be like, oh, well, she did this and this happened and he did. No, what are you doing? Because you see it. You're just ignoring certain shit. And I got tired of being fucking unhappy.
Yeah. I mean, And so your question is, when do you think someone gets there? It's different for everyone.
But how important do you think it is that they get there?
Some people will never get there.
Yeah.
Some people might not love anything enough to want to change. Mm. You can be so distracted with LA. You can be distracted till you're in your 60s and then wake up one day and be like, oh, damn.
What happened to life?
What did I do?
Yeah.
I just got to the point that I knew what I wanted. I want to have a family. I want to do these certain things, and I no longer wanted to be the alpha playboy.
I think you'd be a great dad.
For sure. but I think you have these moments in life. God gives you these moments in life, whether it's getting your heart broken, losing someone, something happening to you. And you have that moment where you go, okay, I'm going to make two choices. One, this is how I've been doing it for the last 20, 30 years, whatever, and I'm going to continue that path. Two, I'm going to take this opportunity and be like, this is not what I want. What are you going to do about it? And to me, it's simple. To me, it's how I run my company. It's how I run my thing. It's like, if I want to make something, I know I have to go make it because no one else is going to make it for me. Yeah. Yep. You know, there's a lot of people that, you know, daddy's going to give you this, mom's good, but you, at the end of the day, you got to go do it. So right. That's where I started reading a lot, going to therapy.
He reads a lot.
And for me, reading a lot, that if you ask people 5 years ago, like me reading, it'd be like, right. Yeah. But no, the truth is, like, I read a lot. And so you have to have that moment in your life where you want to make a change. Because here's the thing, if you don't want to make a change, you never will.
Some people don't recognize that they need to make a change because they feel like their shit doesn't stink, or they're just so stuck in the misery of their life, like, sometimes, and they're just they're complacent. You know, that's one of the things I used to always say, is I'm allergic to complacency. Mm. And it also makes me a psychopath because I'm always trying to improve certain things. And some things I've just learned to be this is okay to be complacent at, because this is a good space, right? So it's determining what's a good space and what's not, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what about you, Don, as far as like, have you felt that there was a change in you that needed to happen at any point in time in the last few years, or you feel like you're just perfect? You're very much so a creature of habit.
I'm very much so. For me, I think, I don't know if it's a change in, so to speak, like, how y'all speaking on it. I think more so it could be a good or bad thing. Just being better with trying to guard my heart. And I, like, that may be from getting my heart broken. Like I said, that could be a good or a bad thing. You know what I mean? Being closed off. But it's just...
But do you feel like you're too closed off?
I could be. I mean, I don't feel it, but just hearing, dealing with women, I could be a little bit closed off for sure. And yeah, I don't...
Very stubborn.
Yeah, for sure.
Listen, we're all so different. You know,
yeah.
I don't know you very well. I know Kale, and I know... Kel and I are sort of like two burning flames in the same. We right. love the highs of everything.
Yeah.
Highs of love, highs of this, highs of that. And we chase it and we get it.
Yeah.
If we want it, we'll get it. A lot of other people don't have that same thing. A lot of the people don't want the high. They want, I'm an extrovert. A lot of people, some, you know, some people I talk to are like introverts and they're like, I don't want any highs.
Yeah.
Keep it low. Yeah. I'm cool.
Yeah.
You know, and so what you go through, what your struggles are completely different.
Yeah.
And so people listen to this, you know, I'm not saying I'm right or wrong. I'm just saying this is, if you're like me, you're going to be like, yes.
Yeah.
But, you know, yeah. your stuff's completely different.
Yeah, completely.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think Don has built this bubble of comfort that he, you know, he has, and it's with a lot of shit, you know what I mean? I think, and sometimes I've looked at Don and I look at how creative, like Don is one of the most talented people I've ever come across in my life.
Appreciate it.
But a lot of times Don gets in Don's way.
Oh, that's what we all get in our own way.
Yeah. But by all overthinking, and that's why I'm glad you said to him, making it, like, because I'm like, this dude is so talented. If you just do it, I've told him so many times about his music or whatever, just do it.
When he does it, he does it,
right? But then he hides it from the world.
Yeah, no, I tell you what one of my problems is. So I always have these grandiose ideas, right? And I know it in detail how I want it and what I want to do. And for me, I might not have the money or the resources to do it how I want to do it. And so in my mind, I'm like, okay, this is not hitting, this is not checking out the boxes for me. And I just say, fuck it, and just keep it moving.
Let me go back, my friend. This is my favorite. This stuff's my favorite. And I have a friend just like you. Very similar. One of my best friends went to college with. Hands down, probably the most creative person
you would,
I know.
You would literally love him. He created a comic.
Yeah, he's hands down the most creative person I know. But he sees it
brother.
In his head exactly how he wants it. Mm. And the things he does create do well. But I say to him over and over again, it's just we're in a different society right now where it is about quantity and quality, but it's about quantity. People want you to see you over. You need to be in everybody's face so much right now because they're going to forget about you if they don't see you in a
Facts.
Week, in 2 weeks.
Facts.
And so the conversation I have with him all the time, I'm like, just make it the way you want it. Simplify it to have it be shorter and then do it. That's it. Because at the end of the day, like, you're like, well, I don't have the money. No, you don't need money. For what? Like, to make music? You can make any music you want at your helm on your studio with all the skills. Yeah. Is it at the exact way you want it? And that's the problem. Is if it's not the way you see it in your brain exactly,
yep.
you're not going to release it to the world.
Yeah.
Because that's not who you are.
Yeah, yeah. Instead of just...
And you know who's missing out?
The world. The world. Yeah, he tells me world. That all the time. He like, bro, you're doing a disservice to the world.
Yeah. I mean, and what you will always put out is amazing because that's how your brain works. And like I said, no one misses out except for the world. There really is no gauge of what is successful.
Right.
What is the gauge? If someone likes it or doesn't like it, is that the gauge? If you make money off or don't make money, if you win awards or don't make awards, like, you know, something I wrote about in my book that I said, I was like, look, if you base it off of what people think, you'll never have made it. Because there are so many people that were famous painters, singers, actors who died. And then years after they died, their work became famous, infamous almost.
Yeah.
But when they were alive, who knew?
Knew, yeah.
Yep,
and facts. So if you base it off that, your only gauge is making it. Your only gauge of what success is just, I got to make more things. Every time you think of something, you have to. Your job is to make it and successfully figure out the pattern to make it. And that's the job. It's your only job.
It's crazy. Really isn't anything beyond that. I think about that, right? So there's performers who may not be the best vocally or talent-wise, but when you see somebody love their particular music the way they love it, and you can tell they love their music, it makes me love it even more. Hmm. I'm like, damn. Yeah, I don't know if I vibe, but yes. Yes. And I am definitely guilty of not making it. Like, I'm the same way. Like, in a sense of my anxiety starts going, it's like, oh shit. Like, I'm applying for Big Brother again this season. And so I haven't in a few years, but I'm like, it's time that I do the audition, whether I make it or not, it's for me because it's important for me to talk about men and mental health to a bigger spectrum, right? And the last few seasons they've had, you know, a couple of African Americans win it. And that's cool. I could go in there with that whole narrative, whatever. But for me, what's important is men's mental health because it's not spoken about enough. And not enough men talk about our anxiety, our PTSD, our own doubts, our self-sabotage. There's so much shit. And then on top of that, if we have mates, the wanting to carry the load, because naturally that's what we want to do, is we want to be providers. Like, that's what we are. You know what I mean? So it's,
that weighs heavy.
It weighs heavy. And I'm sorry. No real man who has it is going to want a woman to have a woman take care of him. I don't know a real man that's got it that's going to say, oh, I need her to take care of me.
Yeah, I mean, it eats you up. I mean, I know tons of people who are dating power women, and it's hard.
Yeah, it's we had an episode about that. With Nicole.
It's really tough. I mean, it's I know the struggles. The interesting thing, the flip of it, why do women choose men that haven't successfully made it yet? From a financial standpoint, because they can easily get whoever they want at that point, per se. And so that's an interesting question that I've had with someone one time.
I sometimes wonder if it's like, just a prize or trophy for them.
No, I don't even think it's a prize or trophy. I just think the individual has to ask that question, which is why? If you're making the same choices over and over again, why? And it's an interesting thing. Because I know for me personally as a man, I have always and will always want to provide more than I am, and I'm really hard on myself. I want to give my people the best life. And until I do so, I look forward to that day when I could sit in a chair next to my family and I've made it. Over and over and over again, right. Which facilitated the money. That is just a byproduct of making it over and over again. And I sit down and I could just go, okay, they're good. They're good. 5 minutes later, go make something else. You know, it's like, legit, that's how my brain operates. And it will always operate that way. But, you know, but it's true. It's interesting. It's an interesting thing. Like, we all have that innate, that's primal.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's just where I'm at. Like I said, I'm supposed to be making this video. And I thought about it because 2 weeks ago I decided, it just came to me. And I went to Houston and saw my boy Leroy, who was on the challenge. And I told him what I was thinking. He was like, dude, you would literally be impactful. And I think I've always liked helping people on a micro level, right? Just because at the end of the day, I do it because it really fulfills me to see people really make life changes. And if I could just be a speckle of influence in that, that means everything, because I love healing, even to sometimes the expense of myself. You know, I could be going through the worst shit, but if I know I made somebody's day better, that like fulfills me, because I feel such a connectivity with life and people. And again, I think that since I've discovered more of how I am as an empath, that's why more I get drained, because I try to take on everybody's shit, right? And now I'm having to be selective on, okay, today I'll take on this amount. Today I'll take on this, you know? And luckily I have Don to go throw my shit on sometimes. But it's a lot to carry, because it just seems like, so here's what I always think. When my grandma died, because my grandma was this way, she would take on everybody in the family shit. And I feel like when she died, she passed that shit to me, because I didn't give a fuck about nobody. And when she died, I cared about everybody. And I was like, why am I now caring about shit I didn't care about? Why am I now becoming the person who I used to tell her she needed to not be? And I feel like that was her last laugh. Like, oh, yeah, you used to tell me this and that. Now here, take all this shit. And I'm stuck with, I care. I cry about shit. Before coming here, I was watching Swimmers, the movie on Netflix. And I started crying. I was like, God,
you want to know a funny line that always hits? It says, what we resist the most in life persists the most in life.
Mm.
And no matter what you fight, it will come.
Oh, yeah, that's like when you
and that's anything.
When you try to stop thinking about the pain of a past relationship, that's all you're going to think about.
Yeah.
When you literally try to block it out, you're literally going to think about it.
It's that famous saying, if you're so worried about someone cheating on you, eventually they're going to cheat on you. If you're so worried about this, if you're so worried about that, if you're so worried about not making money, but then how do you fix that? How do you have that breath of it, of anxiousness go away? But that's the whole thing of what you resist the most in life persists the most. It sometimes feels like the more work you do, the more you overthink, for me, which is interesting. Which is new for me. So it's like I'm new on this journey of self-discipline, new on this journey of trying to make conscious choices that are healthier for me. I'll tell you, like, social media, this, that, walk in the office, people, employees, everybody's like, yeah, right, Rob's good.
Social media's the devil, bro.
Yeah, you're good. I mean, it's like, man. Everybody, the person you portray to the world, they don't see, for the first time, I can authentically say I'm vulnerable. I can be vulnerable in certain situations with people that I've never, ever, ever. I've had conversations with my ex, Sheena, and she was like, who are you?
Yeah, facts.
She goes, what happened? And I go, I'm not that guy anymore. Yeah. And so it's hard.
We have to lose some good things in order to change and recognize later.
Yeah.
I mean, I think I hate social media. And I use it, and it's necessary, because it's been forced to be necessary. But I think about, so I just posted a picture with my girl last night. And I was hesitant because I don't tag her, and I'm like, no, I don't want people in my bed. But I was like, why am I posting it then? But it's also like, no, I want to celebrate the fact that I've found somebody, but why does it matter? You know, I go through the social media, makes me want, well, I need to post, but I don't, but I need
to. The worst part is you're having this conversation
in your fucking head, bro. Like, as I'm posting, like, should I? And it's not, it's like, no, because I'm proud of her and I don't want nobody else. You feel me? So it's like, she's stuck with me. I told her, she's stuck. You stuck, bro. And she said the same thing. Like, we were in Houston and I tried to leave, bro. I was mad about some dumb stuff. Probably hadn't eaten. I've been, as my older age has been coming up, I don't know if you feel it, but I get hangry a lot lately. So when I don't eat, I get a little, you know, a little irritable. And I was like, sometimes, like, well, I'm ready to leave. And da, 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 da. She was like, okay, whatever, bro. And it's just like, she's, in other situations where I've tried to run, people have just let me go. She's like, bro, chill. You ain't going nowhere. And I love that. I'm just like.
Sometimes I think you run because you want people to chase you.
No, I run because I'm trying not to. I'm trying to avoid the hurt I've been through. I don't want to feel
but
it.
But the more they come back and say, no, you're good.
But
no,
I've never had
safe.
Nobody come back.
No?
When I've run, it's.
And I'm the opposite. I do the same thing, hoping someone would come back and chase me. And if they do come back and chase me, that means I feel safer and secure. Then it becomes a bad habit.
I think for me, it's more.
We all do that for a reason.
Yeah, I think I run because
you
it's
run
like,
for a reason, and you have to acknowledge what that run is, though.
And I think for me, it's like I don't want to be a disappointment to not live up to the expectations I have in my head of what I feel like I should be in this partnership. And sometimes the idea of what we feel like we should be in the partnership is not what our partner is expecting or wanting from us at all.
No, majority of the time, our partners just want two things. They want to feel safe. Mm-hmm. They want to feel secure.
Facts. Safe is the number one.
Yeah.
And free.
I would debate that a little bit.
I mean, legit.
I mean, I debate when you say there's so many ways you can go with free. I feel like when you partner with someone, it's pairing. Pairing isn't free. Free is I'm doing this journey on my own. I'm out. I'm doing it. So.
No, I think I speak from free as in a sense of freedom to be themselves, right?
100%. Yeah, I took that the wrong way. So but yeah, the freedom to be your authentic self at all times.
Because we're actors in life. That's why it's so funny that so many people don't think they can act, but you're acting every fucking day. That's what we're doing. We still
have a script.
Yeah, facts. You literally put on different faces. And I think that's where... we sometimes get lost as people because it's like, who are we supposed to be, right? Like, I know you've probably struggled with that as far as like, you know, like I said, being in the spotlight camera, shit like that. Like, that's the one thing for me that gives me anxiety about the whole Big Brother situation, because when I was on Sisterhood of Hip Hop, when the episode came out or the couple episodes I was on, I didn't even watch them because I didn't want to see myself and see how they portrayed me, right? But then I'd go read the comments on Twitter and I'm like, this don't even sound like me. You know what I mean? Like, so it's like,
I mean, it's that's just nature of the beast. You know, I realize there's so many different types of mediums, mm-hmm. That, you know, certain mediums like a reality show is very different than an acting show.
Yeah.
So like when you're a scripted character, you have so much less scrutiny mm-hmm. than when you're going in a reality show. When I did Vanderpump with Sheena, I was not ready for what that was.
Yeah.
I wasn't. Yeah. I was not ready for what that was. I was not ready for...
So that's a different beast.
For yeah. And that, sadly, you know, I in multiple ways. One, I wish the world would have really saw me for who I really am. Mm-hmm. Because I was reserved, scared, hesitant, reluctant, pulling away, running away boyfriend.
Mm.
And that's what the world saw. I feel like I was an asshole. Because I and really it was just a scared person. I was scared. I didn't feel safe. And then you're watching a girl who's amazing trying to make me feel overly secure, overly safe. He's amazing. He's great. He's that. And I'm like, I don't want to be anywhere.
She's good at that.
She's good at that.
She's a very good part,
she
yes.
protected my ass like none other. But at the end of the day, No one ever saw who I really was to her. There's a reason why for 13, 14 years, her and I are still friends.
Yeah.
Because there's that whole other side, which, you know, I wish, that's the only thing I regret about that show, is I just wish that I would have basically shown the world how I actually treat Sheena.
It's crazy because I've never once watched that show. I think I watched, Raquel had me watch the reunion, and I've never watched it. And I go sometimes to their pages and see the comments, and I'm like, even talking about, and because they're my homies, like, you know what I'm saying, and
oh,
I'm like,
brutal.
And it's like, bro, they are evil,
it's brutal.
The shit they get, I'm like, and I take it personal because those are my people. Like, I don't know what the show shows, I just know who I interact with on a mm-hmm. regular. So it's like for me, I, you know, my gangster comes out, and I'm like, bro, I really want to just keyboard gangster these dudes right now, find out their IP address, their address, and pull up. But but I know I can't do that, so. I think with me is I have a problem, and I think that me and Don have spoken about this, is there's something innately in me that says that when I do finally let go of this fear and just do it and make it, the levels of success I reach, I don't think that I'm going to be prepared for. Even though I probably will, but that's a fear of mine, is, hey, there's something in me that there's just a feeling I get where I know that this is where my life's going, but are you fucking ready? You know, as far as just even on a grand scheme of helping men, like, that is my passion. That is just, I want to travel the world and help men all around the world.
Mm-hmm.
And just literally go talk to them, like, bro, what's going on? Like, our conversations, you know what I mean? And give them some tools, but also just be there to listen. You know what I mean? Because sometimes it is better talking to somebody you don't know.
What do you think you're not ready for? The idea of something that doesn't even exist yet?
Yes.
How does that make you feel? What have you created so big?
Nothing. A child.
No, but it's true. No, it's I get it.
So, like, that's what I think about. It's like the biggest thing I've created in my life is my child, and her opinion of me is matters.
Mm-hmm.
Everything she says, how she feels, like, if she's not feeling right, if her mood's off, I'm like, is it me? You know what I mean? So it's like when I open up my life, like, even when we, like, I keep saying like, but even with this podcast, it took you kind of pushing it over the edge for me and just saying, hey, I've got the space. Now you have no excuse. Because I was using that as an excuse for a while. And you were like, hey, here it is. And then once I did it, I was like, okay, whatever. But even now, I still don't listen to the episodes. Like, I'm weird like that, right?
No, it's not weird. I mean, I think.
Like, I come in here, we do this, I go home, and I repost it. I'll hear the sound bites, but I won't listen. And it's just because of, there's something inside of me that is afraid of self. There's levels of myself that I know I'm capable of getting to, but also I think the fear of not succeeding at those levels keep me burdened.
But then it becomes your own worst enemy, because then you're like, well, I'm lazy, or then I'm like this, or then I don't do that, and then you beat yourself up, and then you're like, oh, I'm a piece of shit, oh, I don't do this, I'm not successful, blah, 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 blah. That's the circle. It's not just you.
Yeah.
That's everyone.
All, yeah, that's all of us.
That's every man. That's every. That's most people who want to do things.
Yeah.
Yep.
You go to this thing of like, yeah, but, you know, you go back and you do a bunch of research about people who are actually making it and actually successful, and like, it's consistently doing it over and over and over again and not stopping regardless of what the reward is.
Mm.
And that's...
Or like Mel Robbins' 5-second rule.
Yeah. Everybody has their own different things. You know, that's why I write on my phone. I write 6 personal things and 6 business things that I'm going to accomplish. One of those things is like a Hail Mary. You know, one of those things is like, I want to buy a house here. Super specific.
Yeah.
I want to buy a house in the hills in Sherman Oaks. Boom. That's where I'm going to be looking. That's what I'm going to go do. That's like a Hail Mary if you want to like have a big one. That stuff you can't truly control, because what if the economy goes down? What if this goes down? What if inflation goes up? Like, so that stuff is, I see a Hail Mary. Now you can go out and get it and do it regardless, whatever. But, you know, the rest of it is like 6 personal, and it's tangible things.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I'm going to get my body fat down. I'm going to write a fiction book. I'm going to do this. I'm going to, you know, read once a week. A lot of people set so many expectations for themselves and so many things that are not realistic, because you burn out of yourself. And then you mess up on one thing, and then you burn out, and then you go, I'm an asshole, or I'm a piece of shit. I'm done. I'm not going to do it anymore. So it's like, be realistic. Set up your goals and look at it on your phone. I have mine as my lock screen, because I realize if I don't do it, I'm mad at myself, because I told myself I was going to write a fiction book this year and I didn't do it. I have the story. I just haven't figured out one portion of the story. It's not how I wanted to see it in my brain, and so I'm not doing it, so I haven't done it yet.
So where do we feel like this comes from? Like, I feel like this stems from, like we've spoken before, childhood trauma, as far as the way our habits as adults become are certain traumas and triggers that we've grown, our learned experiences also growing up by things we've seen, right? So I look at my mom, right? And I always say, I don't want to be her, right? But in reality, my mom, when she wanted to, my mom still has, she's gone down, you know, and we've talked, and now she knows I talk about this. My mom had a bad drug addiction. Mm-hmm. When she went hard on her drugs, she went hard on her drugs. But when my mom did everything else hard, she was an all-American athlete. Any job she went at, she was the top. She coached a team that wasn't good to, you know, be great. You know what I mean? So she had that addictiveness, and I'm the same way, that when it's something I want, I'm a pit bull at it, right? But I've also seen her fall from grace.
Yeah.
So I feel like that traumatic thing, as you being a young kid idolizing your mom, because that's why I idolized growing up, seeing her fall from grace scares the shit out of me as an adult. And this is the first time I'm saying it. You know, I've never thought of, like, damn, I'm so afraid of becoming the where she is today and not taking a chance when I don't look at all her successes. You know what I mean? And, like, I also have a fear of just being potential.
Have you ever thought about shifting the way you thought about it and thought about it as, like, you already are where your mom is. You already are succeeding, and you already are failing. Yeah. Maybe it's on different levels. Maybe it's on different things. But that's life. Your perspective is what you saw with your mother. And that's how you perceive it in that. And your daughter might be looking at you and having good highs and lows, perceiving it differently, but looking at it the same way. I think that's just being human. Yeah. It's just being human. There's no tell me one human you know who doesn't go up and down. And if they do, they're lying. Like, my parents feel like they have it all together. I talk to my mom and she's like, oh, man.
Yeah.
This week's dad's not doing good.
And you're right about the financial part, because, like, I've made a shitload of money and it didn't. When I was making the most is when I was most miserable.
Yeah.
Legitimately. And that's why it's just like, when we started this, we talked about it. It's like, bro, we're just going to do it. I don't care about finances, whatever it is. I don't care. You know what I mean? Because I love this. Like, I love having these conversations. But again, you're right on that. That is being human. And maybe that's the ego saying, hey, I'm so different. Or maybe I'm not. Maybe I'm just like you.
I think we're all the same. Yeah. Some have more success in other factors.
Yeah.
Some have bigger pitfalls. Some falls are, like your mother that you saw, were so high. And some saw were more in the public and more bad. Bad is perspective. Mm-hmm. I have stuff I do no one knows about. Yeah. People know about it. They'll be like, yeah, he's low. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's all perspective. I think that's part of this journey of being human and being a man. It's like you're going to go through highs. You have to get out of your own freaking head. You have to make that voice in your head your best friend, that when you are in a low, I used to have a tendency to be like, oh, you're an idiot. You're failing again. Way to go. That's what you do. Congratulations. Way to go, Rob. To shift to be like, when I call you, and if you enter the phone, be like, oh, there you go. You're an idiot, Rob. You're doing that again. You're stupid. I would stop calling you.
Yeah, facts.
So why am I allowing that voice in my head to have that same conversation with myself? And that was the biggest shift that I made over the last year when someone said it to me. They said, well, yeah, is your voice in your head your best friend? Because who are you talking to more than anybody? And until you start liking yourself and be like, okay, you screwed that one up, let's go. When you screwed up, let's go. Come on, get up, go.
Yeah.
And it starts little things at the gym. I want to stop. Why you want to stop? Let's do one more. All right, let's go do one more. It's even
giving yourself grace from that too, because that's one thing I've had to learn over the last year, is giving myself grace. Like, some days my body's like, bro, you are beat up right now. What are you doing?
And even if you don't do it, how are you talking to yourself?
Yeah.
You know, you're good. We get this tomorrow.
Yeah, okay. Facts.
And that's all it is. It's having grace. It's being kind to yourself. I mean, so, you know, going back, it's the human condition.
Do we feel like we're in a society that doesn't allow us to be kind to ourselves?
Well, yeah, because we're pumped in with information and visuals of this is how your life's supposed to be, look, feel. I'm constantly looking for the next high. Always. I need the adventure. I need the this. I need the wild sex. I need the wild this. I need the wild that. I'm constantly searching for it. And if I am not constantly engaged with that, the world is telling us we constantly need these things. Yeah. I can't get off my phone or get off my thing or get off of that without us feeling like, and that's my opinion of it. You know, I feel like we're supposed to search. How can you be content with nothing? How? Everybody else has something. Shouldn't I?
What's crazy? So, like what were we about to say, Don?
Oh, no, I'm just agreeing.
I mean, where do you feel like you fall in that aspect of things? Like, as far as, I think, and I don't know if you're saying it like this, but we overly expect things from not just the world, but from ourselves, I would think, too. I think we hold too many expectations instead of just being and being present.
And yeah, that's me. I'm very hard on myself. Because I see myself in one light, but life, my position in life is different. So I just find myself beat myself up. You know what I mean? And I try to allow myself grace. Like, one of my favorite quotes is it's not how you start, it's how you finish. Mm-hmm. And I try to keep that in the back of my mind. You know what I mean? I'm in this position now, but I'm not going to be this way in the future. You know what I mean? So that's my way of tricking myself into giving myself grace.
I said that one time to a therapist, and she goes, "How is that working out for you?" And I'm like, "What?"
I remember you telling me.
I was like, and she goes, "And how's that working out for you? Having that mindset." And I'm like, "I don't know. I don't like it." She goes, "Okay, so how's it working out for you?" And I'm like, "I don't like it." And she goes, "Okay, I get it. But how's it working out for you?" I'm like, "I don't know. I just don't really." So how? And she kept saying it and saying it and saying it until the point where she go, when I just go, "Yeah, okay, I get it. It's not working out." And it's like, "But what are you going to do about it?" There's no more of that question of like, okay, this is my life. And what am I going to do about it? Because how is it working out? And to your point, that quote, it's not where we're at. It's where we're ending. What are you going to do about it? Yep. Period. Yeah. And it's hard, though.
Life's about attrition, bro.
It's hard.
Life's about attrition. Like, you've got to break through that wall. Like, some people never break through it, but literally, it's a you versus you thing. And we've talked about this every single day. Like, you're competing against yourself on, do you want to be this person that you, doesn't matter, again, what your finances say, but I told myself today I wasn't going to go to the gym, but I did. I pushed through that wall. Or I told myself today I wasn't going to read, but I did. I pushed through that wall. Like, we're constantly in a state of kind of taking the easy route. But then when we take the easy route out of things, it makes life more difficult. And then it's like you have this ego, the ego-driven mind that's telling you you're fucking up, you're not succeeding, you're not shit.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, you can start your morning. And this is what I need to get back on and do about it, like Rob says, is get back on my morning affirmations. The first thing I do when I wake up is speak to myself and affirm myself. Because we don't do that enough. We don't say enough good shit. There's enough shit in this world that tears us down regularly. That tells you ain't shit. So tell yourself you're the shit, you know.
And it's gratitude. Mm-hmm. It's gratitude. They you know, I was affirmations, gratitude. That's not, and then I heard it very eclectically in Jonah Hill's documentary. The therapist goes, say four things of gratitude out loud right now. That now keep saying things in your head that you're gratitude, you know, that you have gratitude for. Gratitude. Keep saying it, and then just start walking. He goes, and all you're doing is you're saying it out loud, you're changing it, and then you're going into your next motion with gratitude, and your life starts to change. You know, and I had to do that four times today. That's crazy. I had to do that four times. Because it's hard.
Okay. I wonder sometimes, can we honestly sit here, if I go around the three of us, I'm going to ask a question, and I want to hear what you say. Don, what do you like about yourself? Shouldn't be that hard to answer. Think about that. Like, yeah, I just thought about that now. I was like, do I know what I like about myself? Rob, do you know what you like about yourself?
100%.
What do you like about yourself?
I'm just a good person. know,
it's good, bro. Safe space.
I mean, I'm crying because it's like, it's happy. I'm happy.
Yeah.
Because I like, I know that when I love someone, friends, I make people's lives better. I have a gift. And I always had this gift. Like, if you want to do something, I can help you do it. Mm-hmm. And all you have to do is say it to me, mm-hmm. and I will make it happen to the best of my ability. And I love so hard, and I love my people, and I can bring joy to the world. And I know I'm a light to help, and I'm a light of service, and I'm a light of positivity. And I know that, and that's the things I like about myself. I know that I can walk into a room and be an empath and know. I can walk in a room and say, you need a hug. I got you. And that's been my entire life. God has put me in places to be of service. Mm-hmm. Mm. And
I love it.
Over the last year, you know, the thing that made me cry was because I've lost a piece of that. My brain was so hyper-obsessed with being the best version of me to start so I can make another person happy. It's hard to be happy when your heart's broken. You know, it's a real thing. Like, when your heart's broken, you know, a lot of men don't talk about that, but it's like your brain can't think of anything but that thing you lost. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And you can't, it's debilitating. And it's
paralyzing, bro.
I mean, even now, I'm moving on and I'm cool and I, you know, but I still think long and miss her kids and miss elements of a relationship that I know I had so many faults in and wished I could have changed. And now I know this person, you know, it's this weird back and forth you have. Like, if I would have made the changes then, if she would have met the person you are now, it would have worked. That's the conversation. So going back, I just go, I got a little emotional because it's like that person that brings so much joy, I lost a piece of it, mm-hmm. but I know it's there.
Yeah, facts.
And I'm doing the work to constantly get it back out. Yeah. Because I have such an opportunity to help so many people, and right now I just get so mad that I'm.
Well, I'll say that you are helping more people than you know, because each time you allow us to have this space, I can't tell you how many people have come and said that they've been thankful that we do this, and that's what keeps us going. To be honest, like Don has had people contact him and really, like, this is what this is built for. I didn't build it for any other reason but to help, and it would not be possible without you opening the space. So I don't know if you listen, but at the end of each episode I say thank you to Making It Media, like, for opening the space and allowing us to have this. So you're constantly helping people in our conversations alone, because I know we'll have discussions and I'll take what we discuss and, you know, help somebody else with a similar situation just off our conversations. You know what I mean? So
yeah,
we're extensions of each other, right? So you're constantly going to be orbiting, and sometimes it's just time to take time for yourself and help yourself. But you are a good person. I knew that from jump. That's one thing about me is I could tell the character of somebody very quickly.
Yeah.
And I knew who you were at the core and who your heart was, and I could see the struggle you were also having, and because I've been through the similar struggle. You know, me and Don talk about it all the time. It's a thin line between the villain and the hero. A very thin line, you know?
I almost want to turn in the villain all the time. I'm tired of being the hero.
Yeah.
I'm good to be the villain for a while.
Every day is a struggle.
So, I just... Again, I'm proud of who you've become since we've known each other, and just your self-awareness that's huge, man. That helped. There's so many people who fight against their natural nature, and you're leaning in. And that's where this journey comes from. It's not going to be beautiful. It's a beautiful mess. That's what it is. Mm-hmm. And through that mess is where you find, you know, the diamonds, where you find, you know, the breaths of fresh air that you didn't know were there, right? Like, I think about my situation with my girl now. The week before I decided to actually give it a chance, I was on this podcast talking about I'm over women, done. Because I was at that point.
Yeah.
And God was like, ha, you think. And then the person who I, you know, I truly believe this may be it for me. And I just think because of the calmness I feel, it's not like, you know, we have our highs. There's no high. It is just perfectly right here. And the lows aren't even low. It's just frustrating, but I still stay here knowing that this is where I want to be, no matter what the fuck we're talking about. This is solid. And I've never felt that much peace.
Mm-hmm. Which is, it's a calm.
It's very calming. And it's not I don't get anxiety about it. I don't. Like, it's just funny how that works, right? But I had to lean into it, right? You're leaning into your feelings, your emotions, and I'm so happy you were able to say what you like about yourself that quickly, because there's so many people who cannot. We don't look at ourselves like that, and that's something that we need to focus on, because when you start to and begin to love yourself more, then you can exude that love to others.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
But there's a my biggest lesson, and the only thing that I hope if one person hears this that's struggling, you know, my old patterns were get in a relationship, break their hearts, maybe break my heart, run to the next thing, run to the next high, run to the next girl. And when I say high, it's not necessarily a drug. It's more of like, go conquer something new. Go conquer money. Go conquer another girl. Go conquer this.
Throw
go
be a playboy.
Go do whatever. Go self get this. Show yourself you're the man. You're the man. Cool. Pat yourself on the back. Move on. Next thing works out for you. Cool. Moving on. Great. And so from the longest time, I basically built patterns. And you start doing this for years and years and years and years, and you start realizing at some point that you have the same thing. Now, some people end up in long relationships. This is my pattern. And so maybe there's one person out there that is constantly finding themselves ending in the same relationships, getting the same feelings, not liking it, doing this, finding the same partners, doing the same things. And then there's a common denominator. It's always yourself. And so the advice I would just give to everybody is, if you look in the mirror and you don't like the person you are for whatever reason, I was still a good person and looked in the mirror. I was like, I don't like you. I didn't have a piece about me. Then you got to sit down and just do the work. You got to sit down, talk to the therapist, deal with your traumas, deal with your stuff, understand where it comes from. And I guarantee you there will be an aha moment when you wake up and you just go like, ah, I'm no longer mad at them, no longer mad at this. I take full responsibility for my stuff. And if I do it again, which I might, because I'm human and I'm an idiot and I will try, but I will try not to do that again. But I am going to tell you that you can wake up and anybody can do it, and you can like yourself. I still go through the depression constantly, more than I ever have been at my age. But I know that it's like part of it's like, yeah, well, because you're going back in old patterns, or you're going this, you're going that. But I'm being nice to myself. I know I will wake up one day soon and I'll have that peace you have. I'll have my partner, not because I need it, because I want it at one point. And I will have a peace, and I will have a child, and I will have a this and all that. And guess what? There's going to be a whole new mess of crap coming along with that.
Facts.
And so it's not going to be roses and peaches.
I will let you know.
But at the end of the day, as long as I can wake up and look in the mirror and be like, all right, you got this. You're a good dude. Go help someone today. Go shine your light. Go make someone impact. And if that's my purpose and that's my mission, then that's for me. If someone else is like, go create something. Your ability to create this podcast is helping someone. your ability to make a music or do this or do something is you're the only one that this is the most. If you don't make the things that you're supposed to make, you're selfish. Because you are the only one that is able to make the things that you're able to make.
Right.
The only one. And I know you don't see it that way. But if you don't, you're selfish. If you're holding things in, you're selfish. If you don't talk your feelings out to your partner, you're being selfish. If you hide this stuff in, it's just so. That's it. That's just one thing I wanted to tell everybody out there. Is just like if you're looking in the mirror and you don't like what you see, it's a journey and it's freaking hard. But just find a therapist you like to go deal with your crap. And just be like, all right, let's see what it really is. Take the time. A lot of people turn, here's the thing, and I'm religious. A lot of people turn to God and put all their stuff on God and do all that. And you should. God is a tool. Therapy is also a tool. You know, like these are, I'm not saying one is wrong and one, both are great.
Yeah.
Do both.
Yeah.
So, that's you know, whether someone hears that or not.
Yeah, I think it's important.
You ain't the only one.
Yeah, and what I want for next week, Don, because I think that's a perfect time to end on, because I can't follow that, is next week I want to know what you like about yourself. I'm going to also say mine. Because
I echo a lot of sentiments that Rob said, man. To be honest, you know, I love the fact that you said being a service. For the longest, I always thought being a producer or being a creative was like, oh, that's my purpose. Like, I know I can create, but I think my purpose is just being of service. I think all that falls in being of service, you know what I mean? Creating stuff not only for myself but for the world to enjoy, to do whatever it comes across to them for, I put it out there. You know what I mean? You make music, who knows how it makes people feel. You know what I mean? I get message, people always hit me about, man, Heartbreak on a Full Moon made me feel this way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? No Exit made me feel love and all these things. I'm just like, wow. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I created this in my bedroom, or just this whole little thought and it being out in the world. You know, even with Warm Embrace, oh, man, it makes me feel sexy. I done had women hit me up about that. It's dope. Just helping family members, you know what I mean? Helping out with my nephews. Like, I was telling my cousin the other day, I said, man, it's a reason why I kind of drop everything or just help you in a manner that I help you, because I understand, you know, how hard you're working, how hard you going at being a wife and being a mother, and on top of that, being in school full-time, having a full-time job. Let me help. I can help. You know what I mean? If it's just picking them up, like, they're my little guys. So I don't mind spending time with them. So I try to find areas to help people, you know what I mean? Even if it's just being on the phone with you,
right,
and just having a conversation, you know what I mean? Just little things, just like you said, man, just being a service to people.
Yeah.
Figuring out pockets where you can help somebody. Like, I think that's my purpose, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Isn't it funny how the more you do for yourself, the less fulfilled it seems you get?
Facts.
Every time. It's like you could spend money on yourself and it just feels shitty, but if you doing something for others or spending money on others, you don't think twice about it.
Yeah. That's real. That is absolutely real. Before we wrap it up, I just want to say a couple things. What's funny is we've always talked about when we die, we want to leave legacy, right? As long as music exists in this world, you live forever. You have music into this world. As long as film, television, whatever exists in this world, you are here forever. Literally. This podcast has now made all of us here forever. As long as there's some way to listen to something, and you think about it, because we can go listen to music from the 70s. We can go listen to Beethoven.
Yeah.
We literally can go listen to things from so far. So we're etched in history already. So why not go out into the world and fulfill more and just be more of a giver?
I'll bring it back full circle. You have one job: to make the things that you're supposed to make. Period. Without that, you don't got a podcast. Right. You don't got music. You don't got a show. So get at it. Whatever's in your head, get it out and make it to where it's something tangible. We all have it. Every creative has that. Next time you run into a waiter, he's like, I'm a writer. Let me see what you got.
Yeah.
And if you don't got it, you're not a writer. Yeah. You know what you are? You want to be a writer.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're only that when you make it. And that is that. And I 100% agree with you.
Yes. Man, well, Rob, I appreciate you for coming to your own studio.
Yeah, you know, I gotta.
I mean, we're definitely going to have you on again because there's, you know, I asked Rob and somebody else to come on and we're hopefully going to get that eventually. I would love to have
we should just do me and my ex.
Yeah, I believe so. I mean, with me as the the helm.
I'm actually doing her podcast, yeah. So we'll see how that goes.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely, because I think that we could have a different type of conversation, yeah. Obviously. Before I give my shout outs, tell people where they can find you at.
You can find me Instagram, Rob's Valletta. You could find me here at the Making It Media office, Studio City, California. Yes. You know, we have my show right now. If you haven't seen it, check out Staycation, the world's best vacation rentals. It is fun. Season 2 comes out this week on CBS. Getting picked up on Paramount Plus, Discovery Plus. Watch it. Season 2's fun. Season 2, I found my voice. Season 2, I found me again. I'm having fun.
Let's go.
You know, I so watch it. I'm excited to see the world, show the world what we're doing. Yeah, that's where you can find me.
Make sure you check out my brother. And once again, thank you to Making It Media for always, always, always providing this safe space for us to have these type of conversations. Don, what do you got coming up, man? What can the people expect from you soon?
We got the show, Best of the Best of the Best. That's coming soon, real soon, hopefully. And, yeah, man, just trying to get more ideas out into the world. More music. I'm going to drop some music. You heard it here first. I'm
going to
drop
some music. He's about to make it.
We shall see.
Music. I got so many albums done just sitting in my computer.
Oh, I know.
Yeah, so I'm going to put some out next year for sure.
And as always, you guys will hear me here. You can always hit me on the gram. If you're ever going through something, you need to reach out. And you're, as a man, if you need somebody, that is my specialty. I am here. You can always find me at Kel Ramsey Ackerson on Instagram, K Ramsey Ackerson on Twitter. I'm usually in Rocket Spaces or doing the Versus, though. You find me at the crib, Netflix, or talking to Don. But yeah, we appreciate you guys for always listening. We couldn't do this without you. We could, but it really is so much more meaningful for the commentary we get, the feedback. We really appreciate it. And again, be kind to each other. This world is hard as fuck as it is. I want to give a shout out. Rest in peace to my brother, Andy. He passed away a couple weeks ago from overdose. If you're struggling with some shit, man, get some help. As a recovering alcoholic, I promise you, you will not regret getting the help you need. My brother was like 32. And yeah, I've been struggling with dealing with that, but just get some help.
Yeah. And talk to your people.
Please get some help. We're in a day and age right now, especially in LA, where fentanyl is taking a lot of lives. Don't let it be you. You have people there that care about you. Trust me. You may not think it, but they do. And on that note, we out. Thank you again, and we'll see you next week.
Peace.